released his first single, Less Than Zero, in 1977. 18 years and over 30 singles later, the Ozone is in Dublin to speak to Elvis Costello.
Better be wide awake
for the falling waves of the boys and the surf. The other side of the sun. Sorry to say that I knew all along. You're no match for that summer girl.
Our first stop is in the heart of historic Dublin. Now, this is Dublin Castle. You have never been here before.
Never.
And he doesn't live here. It's before true. You worry. Did you move to Dublin because of sort of musical connections? Because obviously there are a lot of big, huge, famous bands that came from Dublin.
Yeah. Well, I know some of those guys, but we don't all go around each other's house borrowing cups of sugar every night, you know. I run into the U2s and various other groups. And lots of great folk musicians here as well, some of whom I've worked with when I first recorded here. But right. Once I decided to come, you know, my wife and I decided to move here, really because it gives you the chance to live outside of town. We live up in the hills, and it's pretty wild and woolly up there, and you can make as much noise as you want any time of the day or night, or you can have peace and quiet when I have to do writing and, yeah. You know, the thinking part of it, which I try to do occasionally.
The thinking.
Very like there he is.
The Duke of Northumberland.
The Duke of Northumberland.
Now, a lot of cities, you know, seem to have quite a lot of significance when you look at your song, one of which is Liverpool.
Yeah.
What's the background with Liverpool? Is that more than just being a Liverpool Football Club fan?
Oh, yeah. No, my family's from Merseyside. My dad's from Birkenhead, which is the Cheshire side of the Mersey, and my mum's from Liverpool. And I spent all my holidays as a kid there. And it's a bit like Dublin, really, is that because I've got an Irish name and my family's originally, part of my father's side of the family's originally from the north of Ireland, I'm adopted Irish in the papers whenever I do something good. If I do anything rotten, it's that English thing, and it's the same goes for Liverpool. You know, Liverpudlian singer did fantastic record. If I do a rotten concert in Liverpool, that London singer came up here again trying to sell a load of rubbish to us, you know.
So it has its advantages then. So what do you think of that chair then?
Yeah, I wouldn't have it in my house. Actually, a reproduction of it that they gave to William of Orange, and he was a very large Jaffa as well.
Would you class yourself as a pop star?
No, I think the star bit's really funny. You hear people refer to themselves, I'm a movie star or something. You're an actor that got lucky, mm-hmm. You know, it's the same with music. I'm a musician, I'm a songwriter, and occasionally I have pop successes. 13 steps deeper,
13 steps deeper. Do you think that if you kind of repackaged yourself, that you could attract a younger fan base? For example, like, you know, people who like Blur, for instance.
I mean, Blur covered one of my songs once on some sort of one of those compilation records. Mm-hmm. And so if anybody from their fans sort of gets curious about my records through that, then that's great.
The city that plays a big part in your life, of course, is London. Now, you recently were playing some dates there.
Actually, I really enjoyed this summer's dates, all of them. We played at the Albert Hall first in the summer, and that proved to be a little bit too mm-hmm. intimidating, I think, for the audience to really join in. They're sort of trapped out on it's like a big circus, you know? Mm-hmm. And then we moved to the Shepherdswish Empire, which is much more of the sort of thing that I like to do nowadays.
And the Ozone dropped in for a chat with Elvis at the Empire during the sound check of his recent UK tour. We've just seen you doing your sound check with your old mates, The Attractions. Why did you decide to reform with The Attractions again?
We got together for the same reasons as we did originally, which was because of the music. When we formed the band, it was through auditions, and this time I had the songs already written, and it became obvious who the right people to play them were, and it was the guys. So little by little we got together, and any old sort of squabbles that we'd had all sort of seemed to get, just they didn't seem terribly important anymore. Maybe you just sort of think, well, music's more important than fighting, you know.
So is that why you broke up initially?
We just sort of drifted apart, really. I wanted to do some different things, and then it just sort of drifted. I didn't really think one day, oh, I mustn't, don't want to do that anymore. It just sort of happened. You know, others would probably tell it a different way, but that's the way I remember it. And then suddenly it was 8 years that we hadn't played together, and it was amazing to me. But I'd been doing a lot of things, and so had they. And I think, in a way, it's great because they bring their experience from outside the band, playing with other people. And I've played with other musicians, and I think we listen to each other a bit more than we used to, mm-hmm. which is good.
Everyone's matured.
Well, I don't know about that.
Do you ever look back at your old videos?
Yeah, I think some of them are very funny.
They're hilarious. Yeah.
We did some where we hired a villa in the south of France. But rather than really kind of live it up and act like we were in some sort of soap opera fantasy, we were just running around kind of terrorising the local people. I made a few more serious ones. I made one for Veronica, which was pretty good, and one called I Want to Be Loved, which I much prefer the video with the song than the song on its own. I don't like the record very much, but there's one that actually improved the record.
You've changed your glasses, haven't you? Because you used to have those great Elvis Costello geeky glasses.
I wanted to change for a while, but I'm not trying to pretend I'm 22 anymore. I'm 40 now. And if you just looked exactly the same, just like a slightly aging version of yourself, you want to mark the difference a little bit, you know. It's just a style thing.
Your new single, London's Brilliant Parade. What exactly is London's Brilliant Parade?
Well, it's a collection of little stories and little images of London. Both in a dream and in reality and in memory and as it is today. So it's all views of London, like a series of snapshots of London in this song.
Why did you decide not to make a video?
The dreamier side of London is in your imagination, so it has to exist in the listener's mind as much as in mine in writing the song. So I don't really think without £1 million, and I don't think the record company are going to give me £1 million, you know, to make the kind of picture that I'd like to make to accompany it. So I'd rather leave it to the imagination and hope. I think the fantasy is in the music, you know.
Our next shelter from the cold is the former 18th century Parliament, now home to the Bank of Ireland.
Come and warm yourself by the fire. The lovely warm coals.
Chestnuts roasting by. This is the season part of the show.
So does songwriting get easier as the years go by?
I started writing songs when I was about 14. First time I performed in public was the 21st of September 1969. I found a bit of paper for club when I went that night, just the other night when I was looking through my drawer for some things. But I mean, I didn't do it, I didn't even get paid to do it until a couple of years later, and then it was 50p, the share of the door in a folk club, and then I had a band and everything. So it takes a while to get to learn how to do it, and then I started being professional in 1977. Although I'd made the record, my first record, before I quit my day job as a computer operator.
Elvis left his computer job at a cosmetics factory and was soon to make My Aim Is True, the first of many albums.
Do you sort of run out of avenues to go down? Because, I mean, like, you've got, you know, like, Get Happy was always quite kind of Motown-y, and you've also done your country and western kind of thing, and also classical.
Each thing happened at a particular point in my life and career. It seemed like the right thing to do when I was doing... We went to Holland and made this real furious-sounding record. And then we went to Nashville and recorded a bunch of country songs because that was the way I felt at the time. What a good year. More recently, I have collaborated with the Brazilian Quartet and had to learn all new things. I actually learned how to write music down because I wanted to be able to communicate my ideas to them. Now, when I work in film music or anything like that, I can maybe make my ideas a little clearer.
Artist songwriting still, you know, it still exists in sort of the pop world. here at the moment?
There's lots of different ways of making a record. Mm-hmm. Always there's been, people always get hot under the collar about, oh, songs are dying, you know. They've been going for hundreds of years, they're not going to die out now, just because there's some successful records which are constructed a different way. I was chilling in the shine and the light, not dial doing anything my radio advised. With every
one of those late night stations playing songs, bringing tears to my eyes. Radio Radio reached number 29 in November 1978 and was Costello's criticism of the nation's airwaves. So what about the charts today?
I don't particularly want to listen to a techno record that just sounds like a Game Boy, you know, down a well.
Right.
But that's my choice, you know. Somebody else thinks it's fantastic and it's the thing that makes them want to dance, you know. Mm-hmm. A different kind of music would make me want to dance, or something, and the next person would be different again. That's the whole beauty of music. So you had better do as you were told. You better listen to the radio.
Time to eat, and where better than Bewley's Oriental Coffee House?
Is there anything really Irish that I should have?
I don't know.
No. I guess I'll have...
something very fitting. I can recommend the club sandwich. That's the wrong Bewley's Club sandwich. It's very, very nice.
That's very
chicken.
Filling. Oh, yes.
Yeah. Mm. It would fill you up. You know?
We've been talking about the future.
In the immediate future, I'm going to Spain at the end of this month to do some dates with the Poetical Quartet. I'm also keeping in touch with the attractions. We've got plans to go in the studio in the summer, but we're going to do some dates, a few surprise dates beforehand. So we play the songs in front of people before we
Excellent.
Go in the studio, which is the way we used to always do.
Right. The Our Rights commercial. Do tell
us that
story
again.
We've
got to the really important bit. When I was 17, I think it was, my dad used to do a lot of recordings in the 60s. He was with Joe Loss Orchestra and, you know, he made records under assumed names. One of the recordings that came up was for White's Lemonade. And they wanted a sort of Merseybeat sound, you know, with the nasal sort of background vocals. So my dad said, why don't you come and do it? And of course, 17, never been in a recording studio before. It was a great thrill, and we just, you know, we had to pretend we were the Beatles going, oh, wait, oh, wait, you know, in the background. Very embarrassing, really. Oh, White's Lemonade. A lot of people think the actor is my dad because he did the lead voice. But it was an actor who now I think is sort of quite a respected actor in straight theatre, and it's probably much more horrified than I am that the thing has lasted so long. Oh, Ash Lemonade, I'm a secret
lemonade drinker. Elvis Costello resists attempts by others to pigeonhole what he does. Over the years, he's worked with a wide range of artists creating music that he enjoys and ignoring commercial pressures. However, with top 10 hits in the late 70s and early 80s, wouldn't a little chart success in 1995 be welcomed?
If you have this mania for being loved by everybody in the world, that you have to worry about capturing each new person that could potentially buy your record. On the other hand, I mean, talking on this program obviously gives me the opportunity. There's some young people watch this, and if some of them get curious about what I do, then that's great. I'm going to be on tour when I'm 70 years old, and they'll be coming to see me. They'll only be getting in their stride then, you know. And you know what? So will I. I think you better hold on.